Amen. Amen. Well, can we stand to our feet and give our Lord and Savior just a hand clap of praise of gratitude? Thank you, Lord, for blessing us to be in your presence on today. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We also want to thank God for our online worshipers, those that are worshiping in our cyber sanctuary on today. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise for them. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you. We welcome you. We welcome you in on today. Listen, I'm not going to hold you long today. I have a word that I want to deposit into your spirit. But before we do, I want to reiterate some of the announcements that were made on today to make sure that you remember them. First of all, I want to thank you once again for those that signed up for our marriage maintenance brunch that we're going to have on March the 13th. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise for that. I mean, just one Sunday, and we were able to reach capacity. And so I thank you all for your faithfulness in that. I also want to remind those of you that are connected to the body, you know, the churches are opening up now and businesses are opening up now and people are coming out again. And I want to remind you to join one of our ministries. You know, churches stay small and you keep a family, even in a big church, when you are connected, right? When you're joined to some type of ministry. And we have many ministries here at New Vision that you can come and be a part of, to become active, because we're not just a church in the community. We are church of the community. And I want us to really get involved in what's happening around the community. Wouldn't it be a shame for our children to walk by this church and our people in the community to walk by this church every day and not know anything about us, not feel our touch and our impact in the community? And that's not what we want. We want to come and we want to be a part. God has called us to come here to be a part of the community. And so we can do that when everybody works together, when everyone finds something that they can join in. How many know everybody can serve? Everybody can find a capacity in which they can serve. And so we have our ministry sign-up list that's right outside of the Chad Rivas multi-purpose room. I want you to sign up, and I want you to become a part of one of the ministries, the many ministries that we have here. Amen? I want to say welcome to all of our first-time visitors this morning. Welcome, 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 our first-time visitors. Of course, those that are visiting and worshiping with us for the first time, even online. God is so awesome. God is strategic in everything that he does. He's created this hybrid model where some people come to worship, but those that are physically not able to come, now they can worship online. And so his word can get there. It can get out. And we want to thank God for all of our visitors. We know that there are many churches you could have gone to. You can scroll by us and go to another church that's live today. And we want to thank you for worshiping with us. Let's give our visitors a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. All right. Well, listen. I'm full. I'm ready to declare the word of God. If you have your Bibles, your iPhones, or your iPads, I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we're going to begin at verse 26. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning at verse 26. Let's thank God for our choir and his praise team this morning. Amen. God bless you all. Bless you so much, and thank you. Listen. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning at verse 26. Have it? Somebody say, I got it. Word of the Lord reads, "For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called." Let me let you think about that for a minute. But God, somebody say, but God. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. In other words, I'm going to do the opposite of the way you think it should be done. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world, here it is, and the things which are despised, God has chosen. Did you hear that? And the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are. Here is my reasoning. Verse 29, that no flesh should glory in his presence. God does not share his glory with no man, no woman, no bishop, no archbishop, no potentate. God does not share his glory with anyone. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. Can you say amen? Amen. Today we're going to continue in our sermon series titled, He Saw the Best in Me. He saw the best in me. Don't you know that God is masterful at using misfits? He's masterful at using the foolish, the weak, and the base. How many of you believe this morning that God can take something ordinary and hide something great behind it? How many of you believe that God can take something broken and build something that will last forever? And so God is teaching us a principle this morning that it's easier to take ordinary and hide it behind greatness than it is to take greatness and hide it behind something that's already great. Because when you pull greatness out of greatness, God don't get the glory. But when you pull greatness out of weakness, everybody has to give God the glory. Can we give God a hand clap of praise, because we can testify that he pulls something great out of something weak? Pray with me this morning. Father God, we thank you today for this day that you've blessed us with. We thank you for this rich opportunity that you've granted us to be in your presence once again. We don't take it for granted. Father, we didn't come here today, Father God, for man. We came here for you. We came here today, Lord God, to lift up your name, because we believe, Father God, that there's something that you have in your word that you want to feed us with today. So we came today to give you the praise and the glory and the honor that's due your name. Speak to us from the volume of the book. I ask, Father, that you would anoint my lips of clay, that I may declare your word to these your people, that their lives may be changed thereby. We know you can and have a great expectation that you will. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Somebody say, he saw the best in me. Hallelujah. Most of us, brothers and sisters, we come to church, and because we care, we dress well, because we're going to be around people and we care, we make sure that our makeup is on and make sure that our hair is done nice. We come to church, and because we know we're going to be around people, and because we care, we bathe so we smell good. But the problem is that when certain people see you the way you are this morning, they think that everything in your life is well. And so they don't know that your life is under attack. And so when they see your praise, they don't understand how you had to push your way just to get your praise through. But I've come this morning to help you. I've come this morning to tell them for you that the only thing that's different between them and you is that although you're going through some things, you have decided that you're going to praise God anyway. I I submitted for a new passport, and I finally got the passport in the mail the other day. And I had the passport, and I was looking at it. And as I was looking at the old one and then looking at the new one, something kind of dropped in my spirit. I believe, brothers and sisters, that our praise is the passport that gets us in the presence of God. See, we don't come to church and we don't just sit here because God owes us something. But I believe that when you begin to praise Him and lift up His name and thank Him for all He's done, I believe that His glory shows up. And I wonder if anybody has any stamps in their passport this morning, because when you look in your passport, it shows you where you've been. It shows you the place that you've come from. Is there anybody in here that has your spiritual passport that you look back at how far God has brought you, and you don't need a praise team, but you can praise God because He brought you from a mighty long way? I've come this morning to give God the praise that is due His name. I've come to lift Him up, because if don't nobody else thank Him, I thank Him for all that He has done for me. Somebody shout amen. Amen. If I gave you this morning a task of changing the world, and if I were to say to you, you can pick your own team, I believe that many of us, we would probably look for the pedigree of the valedictorian. You would look for those that have a 4.0 GPA. If I were to tell you to pick your own team to change the world, you would probably look for those that have matriculated to the higher echelons of academia. You would look for those that were good in school, those that have all the achievements and the box of trophies at home. Because it is our fleshly inclination to look at accomplishments to qualify somebody. We look at what people have accomplished in life, and we decide that because they have accomplished these things, they are now qualified. But I am so glad that God does not just look at our accomplishments. Somebody say, I qualify. I'm teaching a seminary class this semester, and the class that I'm teaching is public speaking and debate. And the first thing that I told my class on last week, watch this. I told my class on last week, I said, listen, one of the first things that you must do in public speaking is you must know your audience. If you don't know your audience, you can speak some things that will be over their head. You could speak some things that they won't relate to. I got a funny feeling that I know my audience this morning. And I don't think that I'm speaking to anybody this morning that has lived a privileged life. I don't think I'm speaking to anybody this morning that had everything given to you. But I think I'm speaking to some people this morning that knows what it feels like to have to work hard, that knows what it feels like to have to push and go the extra mile. Am I speaking to anybody this morning that knows what it feels like to make a dollar out of 15 cents? And so when I speak to you this morning, what I say resonates with you, and your response resonates with me, because we can form a bond. Why? Because we both know that God, we can testify that God can put something great inside of something weak. Now, all of the strong people, you might not get this, but for those of us that can look at ourselves and say, God chose me for this assignment. If you know that God could have chosen anybody else, but He chose you for this assignment, you ought to be excited that He chose you today. God can take the despised. He can take the weak, God can take the misfits, those that have been rejected, and though the world may overlook you, I want you to know that God has already deposited something great down on the inside of you. And God will send somebody who don't mind looking past the dirt to help mine the gold that God has placed down on the inside of you. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I need you to understand that dirt comes with treasure. Did you hear what I said? Can anybody testify that dirt comes with treasure? See, people look at you today and they think you've always been the way that you are, but you can testify to them that dirt comes with treasure. And I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that God is not afraid of my dirt. As a matter of fact, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to take care of my dirt. He is not afraid of your dirt. I need you to understand why. Because his grace is greater than your dirt. Let me give you some scripture to back that up. It says, where sin abounds, grace did much more abound. I need you to understand that no matter how bad you are, no matter how messed up you are, you're not so messed up that his grace cannot reach you. You're not so low that his grace cannot find you. I wish I had some witnesses here today that can say God's grace is more powerful than your sin. God's grace is more powerful than your mess up. God's grace is more powerful than your drug abuse. God's grace is more powerful than your bankruptcy. God's grace is more powerful than your divorce. Somebody shout grace. God's grace is more powerful than anything you've been through. And this is why the Apostle Paul could say, he says, I was caught up to the third heaven and I saw some things that I can't even speak about. He said, but because of the abundance of revelation that I've been given, here it is, a thorn was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. Here it is, lest I be exalted above measure. And because of this thing, I sought God three times. God says to me, my grace is sufficient for you. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Why? Because my strength is made perfect in weakness. See, all the strong people, you might not get this verse, but those of us that have ever been weak, those of us that have ever been base, those of us that have ever been down to our last dime, we can testify that God's grace has made strength even in our weakness. Somebody shout, that's good news. What I'm trying to get you to see, my assignment here today is to let you know that God is not just looking for perfect people. And some of you, when I talked about joining ministries, when I talk about becoming active in church and doing things for God, most people talk themselves out of it because they say, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough to be used. I'm not good enough to do anything in the church. And so you think that you have to have a certificate or a degree. You think that you have to do something special to be used by God. What I'm trying to get you to see, God has me on assignment this morning to let you know that God can use anybody to serve. He can use anybody to bring forth his will. Let me give you some examples today, and my assignment is going to be done. God released over 1 million of his people from Egyptian bondage. God says, I'm going to move my people out of Egyptian bondage. You must understand that Egypt was the superpower of its day. And watch how God did it. He found an 80-year-old man named Moses. I wish I had somebody in here. An 80-year-old man who was on the run for 40 of those years. An 80-year-old man with a staff in his hand who was on the run for 40 of those years, an 80-year-old man who had a speech impediment, God says to him, now go and tell Pharaoh, I said, let my people go. You miss what I'm trying to get you to see. God could have selected anybody, but he selected somebody that none of you would have chosen to go to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Then God wants to send somebody to Nineveh to tell Nineveh that they are rebellious. Who did he choose? He chose Jonah, who was also rebellious. Let me talk to this side over here. God wanted to go and talk to a people that were rebellious. He found Jonah, a preacher, that was also rebellious. And Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. I wish I had some Bible readers this morning. He gets on a boat to Tarshish. God allows him to get thrown off the boat, allows him to stay in the belly of the whale, spits him back up in the place that he told him to go the first time. See, come here, let me talk to you. Watch this. God will let you go through things to strengthen your message. Come here, preacher. Let me talk to you. God would, when God sends you on assignment, he will let you go through things to strengthen the message that he's telling you to take to his people. And so then, once Jonah has been spit up by the whale, now Jonah now has substance to go with his message. Now he can go now to Nineveh and preach the message with power, with authority, and with might. The reason you have gone through what you are going through is not because God is trying to kill you, but God is using what you've gone through to strengthen your message. Somebody shout, use me, Lord. Look at how God operates. I just want to teach this morning. We'll shout next week. Here it is. He chooses his 12 disciples. He chooses his 12 disciples. Now, I already told you how you would make your selections, me included. We'd look for those with the highest pedigree. We'd ask him, what school did you go to? Who is your mama name? Yeah, what jobs have you had? But Jesus didn't do that. Look who he selected. He went and he selected fishermen. He selected tax collectors. And he said to them, he picked a ragtag group of men and said to them, y'all follow me. He's getting ready to change the world, and he didn't go and look for perfect people. Have you ever asked yourself, why didn't he go to the synagogues to get people? Why didn't he go to Gamaliel, who was one of the great professors of that day, to get scholars to follow him? What I'm trying to take away from you is your excuse for saying that you're not qualified. He calls you, and then he qualifies you for the assignment. And here it is. David. Do you all realize that on the day that David killed Goliath, he was simply on his way to go and meet his brothers who were in battle to take them cheese to eat? Come here. He was taking cheese. Cheese to the battlefield for his brothers. He was the first Uber Eats deliverer. He's taking food to his brothers on the day that he killed Goliath. See, when Samuel came to anoint the king, watch this, David was not even invited to the party. Picture this with me. When Jesse told his sons, I'm almost where I'm going, I'm just teaching today, it's TNT, here it is. Picture this with me. When Jesse told his sons, go and get ready, because the man of God is coming, he didn't even invite David. Picture this with me. Sons, y'all go get ready. Man of God is on his way. Go and wash up, clean up, put your best garments on. The man of God is coming. David, don't you worry about it. You're too young. David, you go ahead out there and you watch the sheep. He didn't even give him an opportunity to even be considered to be used. And so here it is. Can you imagine the rejection that David must have felt? And I'm talking to some folk that has ever felt rejected. Can you imagine the rejection that David must have felt? That my own father didn't even see enough in me to consider me to be used for the assignment. But oh, my Bible readers will know that when Samuel got there and all of the qualified folk start parading before him, the Bible says that Samuel took the oil, and when he saw Eliab, he said, this must be the one. Because he looked like a king, walked like a king, tall like a king. And the Bible says that when he prepared to pour the oil, he looked qualified, but the oil wouldn't flow. Another qualified person came by and he took the oil. See, the qualified folk being real quiet right now, but here it is. The oil wouldn't flow. Come here, let me talk to the preachers for a moment. Never try to force oil on anybody that God has not ordained. Woo. Did you hear what I said? Watch this. Watch this. Here it is. David, who wasn't even invited to the party, Samuel now begins to ask a question. He asked Jesse, do you have, is this all of your young men? Because I know I'm at the right house. I know I'm in the right place. I know I'm in the right city. I know I'm in the right space, but nothing's flowing. And then Samuel says, yeah, it's right there in the Bible. Samuel says, yeah, wait a minute. He says, yeah, I have another one, but there he is in the field. There he is now keeping the sheep. Surely it's not him. I have another one, but he's too young. I have another one. He's out there working. Surely he is not the one that you want. Samuel says to Jesse, well, wait a minute. He says, go and get him. Nobody's gonna sit down. Nobody's going to eat until you go and get him. I have a question or a text this morning. Pastor Noah, this is the question that I asked the text. When I was reading the text, and the text says, go and send for him. The question that I asked the text is, who did Jesse send to get him? Did you, watch this. Did he send somebody that had already been rejected? I'm gonna shout by myself. He says, Samuel says to Jesse, send to get him. So if one of the sons that had been rejected, if one of the sons who did not receive the oil had to go and get him, then they probably didn't have the right attitude when they went to get him. And if Jesse himself had to go and get him, he probably didn't have the right attitude because he didn't even invite him. What I'm trying to get you to understand is the same person that thought that you did not qualify The same person that didn't even think to invite you may be the exact one that God had. I wish I had somebody that God has to use to deliver the message that you are the one that God chose. And I don't know who I'm talking to here today, but I come to tell you, get ready, because God is about to send somebody your way to tell you, you are the one. Here it is. It's right there in your Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 16, around in verse 11. Watch this. David comes in. I'm almost where I'm going. David comes in from the field, James. And he comes in from the field. Dirty David. Dirty David. David didn't have time to wash up. David didn't have time to go put on his best gear. David didn't have time to make sure all of his stuff was in order. Dirty David shows up. And when David shows up, it's right there in the text. When David shows up, then the Lord speaks. Did y'all hear what I'm saying? Can you bring it up on the screen? So he sent and brought him. He sent. It didn't say who he sent. Y'all got to help me here. He sent and brought him. Now he was rooted with bright eyes and good looking. He was dirty, but he still was good looking. His clothes weren't clean, but he still was good looking. Do me a favor. Look at somebody beside you and say, Jesus is the reason I look so good. Come on, tell him. Tell him real quick. Okay, come on back to the text. Come on. Here it is. So watch this. David walks in. Dirty David walks in. God didn't say anything when all the qualified folk were called up. God did not speak when all the perfect people were marched before him. But when Dirty David came in, the Bible says, and the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is the one. I don't know who I'm talking to in here. I have come to tell somebody, it don't matter that he's dirty. God says, anoint him. It doesn't matter that he's not dressed like everybody else. Anoint him. It doesn't matter that he wasn't invited to the party. Anoint him. It doesn't matter that he was not your first choice. Anoint him. And I've come to tell somebody that the people that didn't like you, they may as well build a bridge and get over it, because God said, you are the one. Somebody shout, I am the one. And although you were not the first choice, come here, let me talk to you. The oil is gonna trace you down. Although you were not their first choice, you are not the one they would have chosen, you are not the one they would have selected, you are not the one, come here, let me talk to you. You just happened to pass by this church. This was not the church you had dreamed of joining. It is not the church that you had on your resume to attend, but God has you on assignment in this place. And when God brought you to this place, God told your spirit, that's where you are supposed to be. I've come to tell you that God has you in this house, and he has you here for a reason. He has you here because he's going to use you. Somebody say, I am the one. Here it is. Watch this. He's the one. And God is going to anoint you in front of the very people that didn't want you in the house. God is going to anoint you in front of the very people. God is going to promote you in front of the very people on the job. God, God help me to preach it right. I'm trying to get you to see that when God gets ready to pass out his blessings, it's not because you are so qualified. It's not because you were so good. It's not because you were the richest. It's not because you were the smartest. It's because of his grace. I need about 23 folk to just shout grace. Watch this. I'm almost where I'm going. Here it is. Now, when God sees the best in you and he begins to pour that thing out of you, I need you, hear me, I need you to stay focused. Come here. Don't get the big head. Don't get brand new. Don't start shaking people's hand with one finger. Don't start getting so funny and such and much. Oh, I don't drink that kind of water. You grew up on that kind of water. Come here. Come here. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the person sitting behind you. When God starts blessing you, don't you start getting all, I'm talking to those online too. I'm talking to you. Talking to you. When God starts blessing you, stay focused. See, this is why, thank you, Holy Spirit. This is why God allows you to stay in the fight. Because the fight keeps you focused. When you don't have to fight anymore, you get comfortable. You get relaxed. When you don't have to fight anymore, see, when you had to fight to pay your bills and fight for rent and fight to be loved, you come into the house of God with a sense of praise because you had to fight. But when God blesses you, you come there and you sit like God ought to be happy that you showed up. But when you realize that it was God that healed your body, it was God that made a way, somebody shout fight. Watch this. Here it is. Watch this. Watch this. David is teaching us a principle. Because the people that you love the most. Come here. I need you to hear this. I'm almost where I'm going. The people that you want to support you the most are the very ones that can't see your anointing. Did you hear what I just said? The very ones, here it is, Mother Wilson, that you want to pat you on the back and say, son, I'm so proud. Daughter, I'm so proud of you. They are the very ones, Tracy, that don't even recognize your anointing. Why? Why don't they recognize your anointing? And this is where the hurt comes. This is where the hurt, this is where the feeling of like, I don't qualify. I don't measure up. Why? Because nobody in my house ever told me that I do. This is where the hurt comes. It's come here. It's family. It's inner circle. It's friends. It's those close to you. Why, Pastor Luke? Why? Because they're your family. Because they're your friends. Because they're the ones close to you. Why? Because here it is. I'm almost going to get out of here. Here it is. The reason they don't recognize your anointing is because they know your flaws. The reason that they don't recognize, you can't come to them and say God is going to use you because they know your flaws. They know your propensity. They know your proclivity. They know your hang-ups. They are aware of your addiction. They know your financial status. They know what grade you matriculated to. They know about your divorce. They know you lost the house. They know all of these things. And then you come to them and you say, God want to use me. God help me to teach it right. Here it is. It takes a very mature person to know all of your weaknesses and still think that God can pull something great out of you. It takes a very special person to know that all the things you've done, God can still use you. I need somebody in here to shout, God can still use me. Here it is. I need you to catch this. Because, watch this, I never will forget that when I told my friends that I'm preaching now. They said, who, you? Steve Hall? Lulicious? Oh, now don't laugh at my nickname as if you don't have one. Because now if we're going to start laughing at nicknames in here, come on, let's hear some of yours. Come on now. You mean to tell, not you. You mean God, you mean Sadie, the lady that does hair. You telling me God going to use you. Didn't you just have a court case last week? Didn't you just get divorced 2 years ago? And now you find yourself having to defend your call to people you love. See, this is why Jesus couldn't do anything in this city. Because they say, oh, that's just the carpenter's son. And he couldn't do many works there. And what I'm trying to get you to see is that through all the things that you've been through, people look at you and they remember your past. They remember the route you had to take to get there. But I've come to tell you that it was the route that you took that qualified you. It was the route that you took that prepared you. Somebody shout, I'm prepared for this. Here it is. I still need you to understand that God is going to use you, I'm done, in a great way. And some of you are sitting in this sacred place called sanctuary right now, and you're sitting there and you're saying, there's absolutely no way God can ever use me for anything. And you have nobody in your house to back you up. But you can't get any sleep. You can't get any peace. Because, come here, when God gives you an assignment, he does not cancel that assignment simply because people that love you can't accept it. And it's a fight to do what God told you to do when nobody standing beside you will say, I support it. And that's what the enemy tries to use, especially early on in the ministry, right? Come here. See, early on in your ministry, early on in your call, when God calls you for something, he calls you for an assignment, you can't help but tell people because you're so excited about it, right? And you want them to know this is what God said he's going to do. And the first thing they say is, Have you ever told people you want to start a business? You tell them you're going to go back to school? And they're going to say, but you got all those kids. You have all that debt. I have come this morning to tell you that God is looking past the dirt. I've come this morning to tell you that God sees the best in you. I've come this morning to tell you as I take my seat that he is now putting a demand on the greatness that he put inside of you. I've come to tell you that the reason that people around you didn't make it and you did, it's not because you were better than them. It's because that God is not finished with you yet. I don't know what your assignment is, but there is an assignment on your life, and God is not going to let you leave here until you do what it is He's called for you to do. And when you're okay with walking alone, it's when, Sister Holly, you get to the place where you find yourself looking at pictures of those who are dead and gone, who you believe would have supported you. Are you feeling what I'm saying? Because it's hard to explain to people the call. It's hard to articulate to them something that you don't even understand why He's using you. But I have come to tell you today that God sees the best in you. I need you to believe it. I need you to receive it, because once you begin to believe it, once you begin to receive it, then you're going to begin to see doors open for you. I need you to stand to your feet all over this building. And those that are watching at home, I need you to declare this with me. Somebody shout, I'm grateful. Come on, I need you to stop looking at what everybody else said about you. You did what they said you did, and stop condemning yourself. There is therefore now no self-condemnation to those who are in Jesus Christ. Somebody shout, I'm grateful. I know that I never should have been. I know that I never could have been. I know that I was the most unleashly to succeed. But somebody say, I'm grateful. I'm grateful. Now give God a hand clap of praise like you're grateful to it. Watch this. I'm done. There is no leader in the Word. Look through your scriptures, study your Bible, and you will see that every leader that God used had to go through a period where they felt they were not qualified. They had to go through a period where they had to go through what I like to call an Isle of Patmos season, where they found themselves on the Isle of Patmos. They found themselves on the island by themselves. They believed they couldn't even tell their family. They couldn't even tell their friends that this is what was happening to them, because they didn't want to be judged. But I need you to understand, God sees the best in you. And he's beginning in this season to pull on it. Because here it is. It's not just about you. It's about those that you are connected to. I was at a home going yesterday, and the lady was 95, 94 years old. And the people's lives that she touched, she was a lunch lady. And there were children at her funeral. She was 94 years old. There were children at her funeral who remembered walking through the lunch line with no money in their hand, just touching her hand and not giving her a penny, and she allowed them to go and eat. They didn't remember what kind of car she drove. They didn't remember what kind of house she was in. They didn't remember her title and her position or what her title was on the job. But they remember that they were able to eat that day because of her assignment. And my question for you is, when you stand before the Lord on that day, and we all will you be able to tell Him, Father, I finished my assignment? Will He be able to look at you? Come here. This is personal now. I'm not talking about your husband or your wife. I'm not talking about the person sitting on your left, your son or your daughter. I'm talking directly to you now. In that day, when you're standing before him, will he be able to say to you, well done, my good and faithful servant? And he will only be able to call you faithful if you accepted and completed your assignment. So from this day forward, stop looking at where you don't measure up. Stop looking at what you've done wrong. And I want you to start saying to yourself, he sees the best in me. Give God a hand clap of praise right there. If you're standing in this place, if you're standing in this place or you're watching online and you're not saved, you've not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I stand here today to tell you there is no better place than in the hands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. From a family of 13 kids, we lost our father when we were very young. I'm the 12th of 13. I've seen a whole lot of things in my life. My brothers have as well. There is no way that I qualify to stand here. I don't qualify to stand here because of the schools that I've gone to. I don't qualify to stand here because of the TV networks. I don't qualify to stand here because of the bishops or the potentates. But it's because of grace. And it's because I accepted the assignment. Even with a taste for alcohol, I said, God, I'll do it. Even with a taste for drugs, I said, God, I'll do it. Even with knowing that I wasn't all the way right, I said, God, I'll do it. Why? Because I couldn't sleep until I accepted the call. And what I'm trying to get you to see is nothing in your life works until you accept what he's called you to do. But oh, when you accept the call. He who the Son has set free is free indeed. I want every hand lifted. And I just want you to repeat after me. Say, Father, I stand today and I accept the call. You said in your word, if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in my heart that he rose from the dead, that I would be saved. Today, that's my confession and that's my belief. So Father, if there's anything good in me that you can use to advance your kingdom, I submit today with my hands uplifted and I say, send me, I'll go. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God a hand clap of praise right there. I'm over my time. Let me command a blessing over you now. If you would lift your hands once again. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord our God establish you. And may the Lord our God give you peace. It is in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ we ask these things. And the church said, amen. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you on next week. God bless you.